in cash things, it's difficult. Lack of professional courage and at time integrity of external auditors, that's another reason. Sometimes it's not really integrity issue, it's a courage issue. Courage in the sense that they're scared. Again, indirectly they're scared because they might lose the client. That's one fear. And at times it's integrity, it's not just losing, it's just making even more by involving themselves with the client and helping them getting things done. So the two areas, but both are unethical. I feel both are unethical. You should have courage, the auditors, external auditors should have to have the courage to talk to the client when it comes to real principles and ethics. It's not a small matter. They have to blow the whistle. I mean, who will do that if the external auditors also don't do that? Then ineffective monitoring by regulatory bodies. There are lots of regulatory bodies. We all know that. SECP, and in terms of banks, you've got central bank, you've got prudential regulations, numbers of things you can see. But then, are they really effectively doing their job? Having is one thing, but doing is another. Doing in the real manner, the way it should be done. Then another area which I also read some of the cases was remuneration and rewards of people working in a corporate world, if they are linked to financial performance, also is one of the reasons that then they start fudging around the figures. They try to do the financial engineering to show better results. You know, because their performance rewards and the, you know, bonuses and incentives are linked to those financial numbers of the company or the organization. So at times this is also one of the reasons that they indulge into such activities of inflating numbers, inflating revenues, recognizing certain revenues which are not really recognizable in that period, you know, bringing them forward or backwards or whatever. Then this is another very, very important area which impacts us in our practices, ethical practices, our behavior. Do we have this on the top of our agenda, wealth? Do we have fame on top of our agenda? Do we want to be the best in our knowledge, you know? Or are we working towards integrity? So these are some of these, they are not all, but most of these aspirations are, you know, built around this. Either we want money, we want to excel or improve in terms of our wealth, we want to get famous, we want to get popularity in our society, in our profession, in our industry, whatever our frame of work is, or we want to be very much knowledgeable, highly skilled, get all kinds of best. So if our priority number one is anything other than the last, which is integrity, then there is a problem. Then there is very little chances that we are going to be ethical in all kinds of activities and actions that we take, even at personal or at professional level, wherever we are. So if our priority number two is integrity and one is something else, then there is a big problem. I think integrity has to be number one. And there is no harm in having a priority of wealth, fame or knowledge, they're all good. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and God has said wealth as a khair, as good thing, not a bad thing, because if you are earning something from right means and spending in the right means, then there is no harm in having wealth or money. But the only problem comes when it is either coming from the wrong source or going into a wrong source. That's the problem. Otherwise, or a wrong action or a wrong activity. So there is no harm in having aspirations for the other three elements, which is wealth, fame or knowledge, but number one has to be integrity, because otherwise we will compromise. I mean, if I think wealth is the most important thing in my life, then whatever it is, you know, I have to go for wealth, I have to earn money, then integrity is on my second priority. So this is something which we have to always, because we talk a lot, as I said, we talk a lot. We talk that this is wrong, the system is not good, the corruption is all over, but who is responsible? Are we responsible? Is there something else, some strange forces that are involved in these kinds of unethical practices? This is from us. People in the public sector, people in the corporate world, people in the multinationals, people working in the United States, they're all people, they're all human beings. Whether Muslims or non-Muslims or whatever, they're human beings. This is the part of the society. And this society has to think on these lines if we want to eradicate these kinds of elements or evils like unethical practices, corruption or kickbacks and so on. Now we'll talk a bit on, as I said, what should be done. Top of my list is character building. Top of my list is not a course on ethics. All right, because I think we have read a lot in terms of ethics, the books, the examinations. Character building is something else. Character building is something different than personality grooming, as I said in the previous slide. Personality grooming is how you look and how you act when everyone or someone is looking at you. This is personality, right? And I'll come to that slide as well, because I'm going to focus a little more on personality, character, character building, what is the process of character building, because that leads to your actions, which could either be ethical or unethical or a mix of both. So we have to focus on character building of professionals. If you're talking of our own industry or profession, we have to focus on our accountants from wherever, whichever institute they are. There has to be work on character building during their studies, during their articleship, during their trainings, when they join organizations and they're junior officers, when they're assistant managers, mid-level people. It is a continuous process. We call it CPI, you know, continuous process improvement. So this continuous process improvement should keep the character of the person on an improving or this kind of graph, that it goes up, doesn't come down. And you don't even need a constant on that, because everything in the world, we know that we want improvement. We want improvement in our money, in wealth, we want improvement in our personalities, improvement in our vehicles, improvement in our houses. If this is 240 yards, we want, and we are aiming for 400, and so on, you know. So on, also on that side, we have to focus. And we have to develop a behavior which is courageous behavior and a principle-based behavior. You know, we have to, and which was integrity, you know, in the last slide, that you do not compromise when it comes to integrity or when it comes to principles, when it comes to right and wrong, then you don't compromise. Implement corporate governance in its true spirit, not just for signing off. If it's a listed company and it's a requirement that you need a statement of compliance and that is why you are doing it. You know, if you are doing things because of regulatory requirements and because we want to publish this in the audited financials of annual financial audited reports, I think that's not the objective. If that's the objective, that's a very limited objective, and I don't think that can then translate into ethical practices in our day-to-day behaviors, our actions, our approvals, our analysis of what we do. I don't think then we can do that in true spirit. Then regular review and or update of the internal controls. That's another area from our perspective we should keep. I mean, we should not be satisfied that fine, our report has been signed off, we don't have any qualification, we don't have any emphasis para and so on and so forth, and that year is gone. And it, which means, and which is a certification that internal controls are all adequate and there is no need to improve. I don't think that's the way we should look at it. Let's change the perspective, let's change our behavior towards these things. This is good that the reports have been signed and they're not qualified and you have no para, emphasis para in the reports. Very good. But still, I'm sure there are areas where there are rooms to improve. As I said, everything can be improved. There's no limit that you say that now we have reached a level that we don't need a single improvement. A single process in this company is not capable of being improved. And we all know that every organization has got thousands of business processes, you know, and each process has got at least, if not, you know, cross-functional, at least within the functional relationships and interactions between people, between various systems, between technology and so on. Whenever there is more than one person and systems involved to carry out a certain process, you need to have controls. And those controls can be reviewed and must be reviewed. I'm not saying that every day you need to review, but you can prioritize. One can prioritize that what are the major, top most important processes that impact our revenues, our expenses, approval authorities, matrices, and so on. At least those areas. And then look at those and see if there are any rooms. And improving the controls does not necessarily mean that you increase the controls or increase the levels. not necessarily. Sometimes even some unnecessary controls are there which are adding to your costs, which is also not good, which is also not required.